Our first afternoon session of the day requires you to open your minds to the world of what is possible with technology. It is called Technology, a Treasure Trove of Opportunities. Before introducing the session, let me first introduce our fantastic moderator who will take us through the session.
Mr. Keshav Murugesh was named as one of the most influential business leaders of Asia by the Economic Times recently and is known as the Turnaround Turk for his ability to steer flailing organizations towards success through innovative strategies. A winner of the prestigious 2019 Gold Stevie for Executive of the Year, he is a doyen of the IT BPM industry and a global thought leader. He has held various influential positions, including that of NASSCOM chairman in financial year 2020. As an industry evangelist, he collaborates with governments and industry bodies to design policies that today position the Indian IT BPM industry as a global hub for talent and technology. He is the architect of innovative business models, including the end-to-end vertical approach that revolutionized the BPM industry. He is also a member of the Wall Street Journal CEO Council and the WNS Cares Foundation Board that focuses on education for lesser privileged children. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome Keshav Murugesh, Group CEO of WNS Global Services. In the last 30 years, the world has been dramatically reshaped by technology. 3.4 billion internet users collaborate with each other every day. Artificial intelligence, cloud, and big data find their way into everyday conversations. India's IT industry has experienced significant growth, going from just US $1 billion in 1990 to US $180 billion in 2019, with 75% of it in global exports. IT and IT-enabled services are growing at 7.7% and are expected to reach a colossal $350 billion by 2025. On hardware too, India is on the global radar. Samsung World's largest mobile factory is in Noida, and Apple's OEM Foxconn has just announced $1 billion investment in Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu, with its rich ecosystem, is targeting to generate $100 billion in revenue from electronics manufacturing, a colossal 25% of that of India. 30% of India's SaaS business, of about US $1.2 billion, is done from Tamil Nadu, with bright prospects of this going to US $5 billion by 2050. A 10 times valuation gives a possible wealth creation of a colossal $50 billion. A submarine cable linking Asia greatly increases network speed. Space sector is being opened up. It's technology, technology, and more technology wherever we look. Time is indeed ripe for technology to redefine India's role in the world.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It is indeed such a pleasure to be here chairing this session with such wonderful panelists along with me. Before I start, I thought I should definitely take a moment for all of us to remember the person who we all considered the father of the Indian IT industry, who we lost last Thursday at the age of 96, Mr. Fakir Chand Kohli, who contributed so much to India, to our business, and to future thinking around technology. And I hope as we speak today, all of us will remember him and the spirit that he stood for. So first and foremost, let me just hope that all of you who are here today are safe and healthy. Frankly, I can virtually feel the pulsating energy of today's audience. And it is indeed going to be a very exciting interaction with this great panel and a fantastic audience. I want to really congratulate UEF for organizing this multidimensional global summit to build business partnerships that can aid economic and social development for Tamil Nadu as well as India. Let me start by asking if you've heard the word kibbutzim. The word is the foundation, if you ask me, of Israel's journey from the land of milk and honey to the innovation nation as it is known today. It symbolizes the power of collective communities in transforming a nation, what we today currently call an ecosystem. It all started when immigrants from more than 130 nations collectively experimented with new agricultural methods and social structures. This set the pace for innovation and fearless risk-taking in every sector. They call this the chutzpah. It's a spirit that they define here. And it has been, if you ask me, the driving force for this very, very tiny nation that has given the world some of the greatest technology innovations. In fact, I may remind you that 6 Israeli technology innovations were featured in Time magazine's top 100 inventions of 2020 alone. Let's travel to another small region in Europe, the Nordic region. 4 countries, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, and Norway, made it to the 2020 Bloomberg's list of the top 20 innovative economies of the world. In Sweden, which is known as the Unicorn Factory, it has one of the highest number of billion-dollar startups in the world. And across the Atlantic, in the US, we all know about Silicon Valley, housing the world's most important centers of innovation and tech disruption. And so it brings us to the question, what makes Israel, the Nordic region, and Silicon Valley game-changing hubs of innovation that transform the world? Technology and innovation are indeed very powerful instruments of change across the whole world, but it needs a concerted will-do spirit, collaboration, and institutional support, something that UEF, through this conference and other initiatives, have been driving for Tamil Nadu. Today's discussion will be centered around how we can make this work for India at large, and also for the state of Tamil Nadu in particular. Can we look at new age and high-tech startups to leverage our manufacturing prowess? Can we look at becoming a bigger technology innovation and employment hub? How can we foster industry, academia, collaboration to make India and the state of Tamil Nadu a global talent hub? And how can various enabling networks and investors play a more prominent role in boosting technology innovation? Today, we have a very eminent panel with us to provide diverse viewpoints and recommendations to spur thinking. And I'm using the word spur thinking because we are hoping that members of the audience will use this session to think of new ideas that will drive the greatness of Tamil Nadu or India and drive innovation along the lines being recommended by some of them. Let me now introduce each of these special people to you. First of all, Padma Shri, Dr. Y.S. Rajan. He has donned multiple hats over the course of his exemplary career: scientist, technologist, diplomat, academic, writer, and poet. His contributions in shaping ISRO from its initial experimental phases into a major service delivery organization have been truly remarkable. He has played key roles at CII, TIFAC, and has also led a number of Indian delegations to the United Nations. Welcome, sir. Next, we have R. Chandrasekharan, the former chairman of NASSCOM and former vice chairman and co-founder of Cognizant India. With a 34-year sterling career behind him, Middle Chandra, as we like to call him, because in the industry, we have Chandramukhi, 3 Chandras. And we have the former Chandra, president of NASSCOM, then we have this Chandra, and we have N. Chandra, who now runs Tata's. So he's called Middle Chandra, but he serves as an independent director on the boards of several companies in the financial and technology services industries today, and finds time for his passion in Carnatic music for now, since he cannot travel or go for golf, I am told, during the pandemic. The third very eminent speaker is Velachami Shankarlingam. He is the leader and president of product engineering in a brand that has got us all connected even today, literally known across the globe in minutes after the pandemic struck. Zoom, that's the company, you know, he runs as president. Velachami, you really define, you definitely, I must say, have a great, great product. Prior to joining Zoom, he has had stints at VMware and Cisco. And he's also on the board of Bellus 3D. And I'm delighted to tell you that he's staying up very late to join this session from California, just for all of us. I must now explain, you know, how we're going to run this panel. We have the luxury of 90 minutes totally to brainstorm with our panelists and also our diverse and energetic audience and professionals who are, you know, in the audience as well. So let's start. First, I will request Mr. Chandra to share his views. You have 10 minutes, Chandra. You're on mute.
You're on mute.
Always happens. Okay, thank you, Keshav, for the warm introduction, and thank UEF for organizing this wonderful virtual event. I'm very glad to be part of this, and you know, we're all used to having this virtual sessions over the last 8 to 9 months. Now, I remember speaking in a similar event just a little over a year ago. When I was a topic also was emerging technologies and how things would change around us. And little did I realize that change would happen so soon. And I just took some talking points from, you know, that speech, and I wanted to just briefly narrate. You know, I was talking about how the emerging technologies, you know, particularly the digital stack, would change the businesses around us, would, you know, change. The business models will change from B2B to B2C and government to citizen services, how the future generations will be educated, right? And farm productivity, how technology can help in enhancing the farm productivity, and also how we are going to consume, right? How we are going to eat, how we are going to commute. Everything will undergo a sea change, right? And how we are going to work in future. I mentioned all these points, and I was thinking of a time horizon of about 4 to 5 years. And little did I realize that most of that would become a reality within a span of 10 to 12 months. And that's where we are today. And frankly, we have to thank COVID for one positive influence that it has had in all our lives. You know, it has accelerated implementation of technology for betterment of life, right? And so that's one positive outcome of COVID. I don't want to talk about the negative stuff that we all know, but it's all possible because of technology, because of the digital stack, which has been sort of emerging over a period of time. And using this digital stack, the virtual world has taken over the physical world. You know, the expectation for the future is both will exist, the virtual world as well as the physical world. So what we call as the digital world, that's going to be the future that we will witness after this pandemic is done with. And it's all possible because of faster adoption of digital stack. You know, whether even if you look at the Indian context, you know, it is the faster mobile penetration. You know, we are able to take services to the last mile, right? And the devices that we use are much smarter. You know, all of them have some kind of an artificial intelligence sort of embedded into, you know, these devices. And as per Gartner, you know, this was a projection in 2017, 85% of devices that we use would be smarter because of the artificial intelligence implementation. But I'm sure probably it has crossed more than that 85% as we speak today. And leveraging cloud so that, you know, seamless expansion of the infrastructure that we need to operate in the digital world. But if you really look at on the ground reality, it's even more phenomenal. You know, look at what Government of India has done. You know, I remember talking about this vision of 1 billion, 1 billion, 1 billion, right? It's the 1 billion Aadhaar identification where we have really changed the physical identity of individuals to a virtual identity. crossed 1 billion. 1 billion bank accounts, so that the government can directly transfer the benefits to the end consumer, end citizen, without any intermediaries. 1 billion bank accounts, we have crossed the threshold. 1 billion mobile phones, I think we have crossed or very close to crossing that milestone. And if you really look at it, you know, we are, the, you know, because of this 1 billion, you know, today a fully inclusive financial ecosystem is already in place in India. Now we are able to deliver government to citizen services, leveraging this physical identity, leveraging this mobile technology and eliminating all the intermediaries. That is the power of technology. And Keshav mentioned about Israel, how it has been the power of innovation. I'm very proud about what we have done in India. You know, we are the powerhouses of implementation, right? Leveraging technology for the betterment of people. You know, if Israel is innovation, India is putting innovation to use at scale, right? It's par excellence. And I see brighter future as we look ahead in terms of how technology can be put to use in our businesses, as well as, you know, bringing more innovation, using these technologies, how can we introduce better products, solutions, and services, you know, to serve people and also to grow businesses around the globe with India as the anchor point, right? And so, you know, that's what we have seen. You know, a digital technology implementation has been accelerated because of the situation that we are faced with over the last 10 months. But the future looks even brighter. Now, I have seen various research reports, you know, pointing to how technology is going to fuel phenomenal growth for Indian business. How technology will add significant economic value to the Indian economy. Let me give you some examples. Today, the IT industry is around $200 billion, right? And if the same thing continues at the same pace or, you know, a little bit more innovation, we're likely to see that grow from $190 billion, $200 billion to about $350 billion by 2025. And given the past track record, I'm sure, you know, we are on the right track in terms of what we need to do as an industry to get to $350 billion. But we are not going to stop there. And, you know, with the government, you know, focusing a lot more on, you know, make in India, make for global, make for India, all this, you know, sort of initiatives, there's going to be impetus on electronics manufacturing in India. That is going to add another $150 to $200 billion to the economic parameters of India. And on top of it, you know, leveraging technology, we are going to enhance the farmers' income, almost double farmers' income through farm productivity and creating channels for them so that they are better off tomorrow. And that's going to bring in another $15 to $20 billion economic value. Right? And education for all, healthcare for all. You know, if you add the economic value of all these initiatives, you know, we are really looking at $1 trillion economic value by 2025. And this is not a pipe dream, you know, it is actually has been broken down into various initiatives that are going to be put in place or that are already on the way. And we will definitely see this $1 trillion economic value by 2025. And I have no doubt if at all it can happen sooner. And that's the way we are going. And all these things are actually aided by, you know, focus on emerging technologies. But having said that, you know, if I look at the IT BPM industry alone, you know, for I've been part of this industry for the last 34, 35 years, you know, we have seen significant change. And we are likely to see even more change looking in the short term or medium term, where the focus is going to shift from purely services to products and SaaS-based platforms. Of which I'm very proud to say that Chennai is becoming the SaaS capital of the IT industry. You know, we already have two or three unicorns, you know, who actually were founded in Chennai, Freshworks, Zoho. And these are all poster childs of SaaS platforms from India. So such initiatives are going to be, you know, forthcoming even faster as we look ahead. So you'll see a lot more software product companies, software platform companies offering services on their platforms. And that's going to be a significant change in the way IT services is going to grow in future. And also, you know, when I look at the future, you know, the digital stack will continue to grow, you know, what we call as the SMAC, social, mobile, analytics, and cloud. You know, these are the terms that we have been using for the last 7 to 8 years. And they have the founding technologies to all the good things that we have seen so far. But the future looks even brighter. You know, leveraging these founding technologies, a combination of these technologies to deliver some unique value proposition for end consumer is what we are likely to see as we look at it, right? So if I look at the future, that, you know, we have seen enabling technologies, we are likely to see future disruptors. What are those future disruptors going to be? You know, I'd like to see digital reality. What do I mean by digital reality? It is actually a combination of several technologies, you know, augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, voice interfaces, 360 degree video streaming and data, ambient computing, and immersive technologies. All these things actually provide a natural user engagement to seamlessly interact with human-centric or human-centric experience systems beyond what we are used to today. Today, we are interacting with the systems of the mouse and the keyboard, right? But in future, ambient computing, immersive technology will enable us to seamlessly interact with the futuristic system. And that's going to, you know, lead to many new solutions that will enable technology to live as part of our life. It's not that we have to interface with technology. They will be sort of part of our life's existence. And that's the type of, you know, digital reality based technologies that we are likely to see. And the other thing is cognitive technologies. You know, we have talked about robots in factories and the future workforce itself, we need to learn to coexist with the machines. So the man-machine interface will definitely undergo a lot of changes. So we're going to see a lot of cognitive technologies. These are machine learning, neural networks, robotic process automation, natural language processing, neural networks, and broader domains of AI. And this will transform the way every industry is going to be, you know, functioning in future. So cognitive technologies, digital realities will be the force to reckon with as we look ahead. And the blockchain, you know, contrary to the belief, this has not really taken off as much as we thought it would, right? I think financial services industry has leveraged blockchain to a great extent, but we are likely to see other industries are also going to embrace blockchain, you know, for delivering value to end users, whether it is the pharma industry, agriculture industry, you know, healthcare, media, everybody is going to leverage blockchain, and that's going to be another, you know, technology development that we need to be abreast of and probably leverage to implement some state-of-the-art solutions that will benefit everybody. So the future is going to be extension of digital technologies, but a combination of these technologies to deliver digital reality, cognitive technologies, and blockchain, right? So what are we going to use these for, right? That's where I think we need to sort of bring this newer thinking to your real life solutions. In future, we are not going to be seeing a purely a sort of a discrete technology-based application. You know, if you look at a device, you know, IoT, you collect the data, build some algorithms, and put artificial intelligence on the device. That's a very discrete way of looking at data analytics and artificial intelligence. But we are going to see a combination of technology forces coming into play to create a unique platform. So what are platforms? Sorry.
So clearly what you are defining is the business is now technology. And I'm sure we'll have a lot more to discuss, but I would like to move on to the next panelist so that they could provide some introductory comments. And then during the Q&A, we will, you know, talk about some of the other things. I'm sure you want to talk about skills and a few other things as well. If it's okay, I would not.
To other people. Sorry, Keshav, I didn't realize I got carried away by technology.
I will keep everyone honest here. Don't worry. Velchami, if you don't mind, you know, can you go next and give us a sense, you know, from your point of view, because Chandra has already said that technology is now the business, right, of life. So continue from there, please.
Yeah. Hey, thanks, Keshav. Chandra, nice talk. Thanks, UEF, for bringing all of us together. And Thanks, Professor Rajan as well. Glad to be in the panel with all of you. Just a brief background about me. I was actually born in a small town called Virudhunagar in Tamil Nadu. And then I studied there. I studied in a boarding school called Montfort and Aircard. And then I did my undergrad in College of Engineering, Guindy. And then I went to the US to do further studies. So just to connect that to where I'm at Zoom. So I worked at many large and small companies. And then I was working at a startup. And then the startup got bought by WebEx. And that is where I met Eric, the founder of Zoom. And then we worked very well together. We were running all of engineering and the operations for the company. And once Cisco bought WebEx, I was there for a few years, and then I left to go to VMware. And then Eric actually went and started Zoom. And I joined Zoom earlier this year. And I think the driver was, as you know, that Zoom was already doing well, growing like really fast. And with the pandemic, I think the Zoom's usage went like 30 times overnight. So the company basically has grown like between, like end of last year, there were about 10 million attendees on a daily basis to more than 300 million just beginning of this year. And so one of the challenges is the growth and scale. And then Eric had reached out to me to see if I can come and help. And then I think I joined Zoom because Eric is a great friend. And the other is Zoom is making such a big impact to the world through COVID, et cetera. So that is sort of my background on where I started and where I am right now. One of the things that I've seen is you know, like what Chandra said, there are some side effects of the pandemic. I hear an echo. Is that?
Yeah.
Okay, let me continue. So the I see with COVID is that whatever the transformation that is supposed to happen over many, many years, now actually has completely happened in the past few months. Is the echo still there? Sorry.
Any chance have two devices in your room, Beltami?
Yeah, let me see if I can.
One of your devices.
Yeah, let me see. Okay. Just 1 second, let me just check.
It sounded
okay. It seems to be okay. Seems to be okay.
Better?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I think one of the things that we have seen is a lot of changes that would have taken like maybe a decade have happened through this period. And I think part of it is look at like, where do you work? It used to be that you work in the office. And then sometimes you have an exception where you work from home. Through COVID, if you look at the whole tech industry worldwide, pretty much everybody has been working from home. And the change of this is, there is a lot of implications to this change. What this does is now people where, you know, you have all these technology hubs, like Keshav talked about, Silicon Valley talked about all of that. With this changes, the way I look at it is the advantages a lot of these hubs have, I think it's going to be like every other place in the world, like smaller towns, smaller university towns are going to have pretty similar advantage. Because now what has happened is the location doesn't matter. And one change with that is like, whether you do it in India, whether you do it in US, I think it's slowly going to delineate that. The other problem, what I've seen, like running all these companies, I always had like a huge Indian component. The challenge is always hiring people because there are few hotspots where people, the MNCs come and hire. It's Bangalore, it's maybe Noida, it's like Pune, et cetera. And this sort of drives the whole cost up there, and the talent is you're fighting for the same talent pool, et cetera. I think one of the opportunities I see both from in India and from Tamil Nadu is this change of where you work doesn't matter anymore. It's going to break a lot of new opportunities for the smaller towns, et cetera. And I feel like now most of these MNCs, I think they're all hiring to say that we don't even know where the office is going to be. We can hire people remote, whether it's any country doesn't matter, any location doesn't matter. It's also going to give opportunities for a lot of these, and also the expansion of the talent pool. There is a lot of talent pool in Tamil Nadu. I think if you look at Bangalore, I would say like half the people come from Tamil Nadu. But all of this is because there is an ecosystem there. There are a lot of companies there, and then you actually gravitate towards an ecosystem. But these ecosystems are going to become more virtual. So you can actually create all these ecosystems wherever you are. And it's going to make a lot of changes to like work-life balance as well. Because today, if I go to Bangalore, one of the problems that I have is if I take my team for a dinner or anything, it's like a 2-hour drive for them. And then by the time they get home, it's pretty late night, et cetera. So if you imagine that every small town in India has like a ecosystem where MNCs or large Indian companies can actually hire these people, it doesn't matter where they live. The only thing that matters is they have the skills and they have the connectivity. Okay, so whether it's 5G or internet with redundant power, that is all is going to be needed because of the transformation that has happened through this, the side effect of COVID, like Chandra said. I think it's COVID, I would say, had a lot of negative impact, but I think the positive impact is it has made a lot of these companies realize that you can have people work from anywhere. And that actually opens up a lot of opportunities for India, and actually I would say in Tamil Nadu as well. Every educational institution that is there could become an ecosystem that can actually create all these small Silicon Valley type nodes. And it's going to actually help as well, because now you can spread beyond these major towns, and you don't need to go to these cities to work. You can actually work where you were born. You can actually work where you live, et cetera. So that I think is like a big change, I feel. I mean, part of it is, I was a strong believer before COVID that I need to be in the office to be productive. I normally get to the office early in the morning, and then I always come late. And I always felt like if I don't go to the office, I cannot work that well. But since I joined Zoom, I haven't been to an office. Pretty much all my work is through Zoom. And I feel like the immersive video is pretty close. And I would maybe say that I myself might have changed to say that, okay, look, maybe I don't need all my team to be in the office. We do need to meet once in a while, but it doesn't mean that we can't get the job done without having to have everybody physically there. I would say that's one of the biggest changes. And I think the impact of this is we're going to feel it even after COVID. Because if you look at it from a company standpoint also, I think there is a huge investment all these companies make for real estate, for running these offices, et cetera. All of that is, there is a huge incentive for companies to say, maybe we don't need this. And there is a huge incentive for all people in a smaller town, et cetera. You don't need to go to Bangalore or you don't need to go to Chennai to work. Maybe you can actually work where you are, et cetera. So that's something that I see through COVID and all of this. And similar to what Chandra said, there is a lot of innovation that's happening. If you look at AI, et cetera, you know, the background, it's actually virtual. So if I actually move back, I'll disappear. It'll be like Star Trek or something like that. So there is and then the audio that we have, there is a lot of innovation there to say, if I have a dog barking in the background, we have technology to sort of take out the noise, et cetera. And I think the goal is over time, these virtual interfaces are going to become better than your real interface. You should be able to touch, you should be able to feel, you should be able to do a lot of this stuff, et cetera. So there is a lot of innovation happening in this area. And I believe that the transformation that has happened now in the past year is something like a 10-year transformation in normal time. I think COVID has accelerated a lot of this transformation. I think the last thing I would say is I hear there are a lot of students in the audience as well, a lot of the UEFs, colleges, etc. So I normally, I like meeting with new college grads whenever I meet, like whenever I come to Bangalore or I go to any of the offices, etc. I would say the world is basically very different today. When I started working, you can keep your life and your work completely separate. So even if you don't like your job, you can actually go home and then be a different, you can have a life and you can have a job. You know, with the globalization, that is all, that changed to one level. Okay, so your day and night, you lost, both of them merged together. And then with all the technology, network connectivity and all of this, you pretty much, your work and life is all merged. So my suggestion to you would be find something you really like, because you're never going to be able to like split your work and life that easily. So find something that you really like and you'll do really well in those. I think the other thing is, you know, people talk about all the Silicon Valley, all the successes there, et cetera. The thing is there are so many more failures there, okay, in addition to successes. So one of the things that all of you need to look at is all startups, whatever you do, et cetera, there is always going to be, I think you need to take a lot of risk like to succeed all of this. For every Zoom, there may be like 10 other companies that are not like not successful, et cetera, as well.
Can you hear me?
That, Keshav, I'll hand it back over to you. And thanks for the time.
Thank you. I think that was perfect timing. And I think great advice to the students in the audience as well. And now we should move to another very exciting area, which is very motivating, you know, for every Indian, source of national pride, huge source of technology innovation. That is the whole space area and the entrepreneurship opportunities around that. I'll now request Professor Rajan to say his few words, 10 minutes to you, sir.
Namaskara to everybody on the 2D screen and many thousands who are watching whom I can't see. I thank the organizers for giving this opportunity, especially for Ahmed Bukhari. I have to say, he insisted that I should come. Last two times I couldn't come because I couldn't come to Chennai. Now, virtual one has made it possible. It's a pleasure to be along with these wonderful and also powerful panel members. One clarification, all my associations with ISRO was former, but still the proud memories. I would be attempting to give some glimpses of many opportunities into space industry. I don't call them treasure trove of opportunities alone, treasure trove of business opportunities, not just for excitement and pride. We had been a part of the great pride, but it is not for excitement and pride anymore. Also to make good money on your investment. Sarabhai knew it at that time. It is not just for pride. It is the country needs. And for the sweat you will give to create many new businesses based in India, supplying to the large market in India and also global markets. Had this UEF event had been 6 months ago, I would have politely declined. I would have just said that I'm not going to talk because the India's policies on space sector were highly restrictive. Even the major industries which contributed to the Indian space program from 1975, great ones, I won't take each name of them, including the SMEs. They're doing just job orders for the design and specifications given by ISRO. For the downstream businesses like SATCOM, etc., it was routed through Antariksh. So they could not do creatively many things. Policy for really opening up business of India took place both private and public sector. Even public sector could not get into whether they want to do it. And foreign companies and investors took place in a simple statement by the Indian Finance Minister during one of our speeches. Later, PM followed it up. Government, I thought that, you know, people tell things take time. Government of India moved fast to put an institutional mechanism called InSpace under Department of Space. I know of companies already started using that channel and bringing investment. I'm not going to tell about more than a dozen are there. As Providence would have it, as if the curtain raiser to the UEF, an Indian startup, Agnikul, you would have seen it in the small news item, has been given an approval by government to use ISRO facilities to build a launch vehicle of its own design with the new innovative technologies. I'm not describing all the technologies here. It has risen funds from abroad too. It is a great step forward. It has never taken place in Indian policy. The launch vehicle will be about 100 kg. It's not just 5 years, but 2022, they will launch. It's a great step. Then today's breaking news, because nowadays we say breaking news type of thing. You see the front page with all so many things which are around, the statement by Shivan, the Department of Foreign Company, you see the Times of India, which says, which has the Department of, Secretary Department of State, that is a government authority. One of his statement, I'm going to read it out, quote, allowing space firms access as two objectives. Bring more investment and talent to India, not just investment, talent to India, and ensure our products enter global markets. Foreign firms wanting access must invest in India through FDI. Give me clear this thing. It's unquote. Then the news further says, this policy comes very close to the heels of a policy allowing, this was only a few days ago, foreign firms to make and launch satellites and launch vehicles using their technologies in India. Now they will also get to ISRO's technology. This other thing which he has told today. These changes and actual approvals, because changes in policy, I always take it with a little more than a pinch of salt. Taking immediate things are taking place at rocket speed. Mach number beyond that, that's why I'm saying rocket speed. I'm emphasizing this to all those present here who are listening, listen this carefully, who would have been frustrated over the past several years to enter into the space enterprise in India, when the whole world was full of new enterprises and technology, not just SpaceX, but several revolutionary changes as small satellite, 3D printing, electric propulsion, robotics, etc. If I list them, it will be too big. India was slow. But now it has opened up the space sector with a bang. Early birds will access. So gear up, and I will give a few glimpses now. Because I want to emphasize this, even our Ahmed Buhari, past 2-3 years, we have been in talk. He will come up with very good ideas. I'll say, hey, Baba, we can't do it because you'll have to go through this such a solutions that you can't get in. So now, those who want to enter, not only be the early bird, go and pick it up. Because all opportunities have been opened up. To enter space business or space enterprise, you don't have to enter only through law. Now I'm saying, people will think rocket. That is only space. It is not. It is, you need not enter only through a rocket or a launch vehicle maker or a satellite maker. While these are prestigious and exciting, they require high risk and high investment. When successful, returns are moderate. I want to tell you, if you were SpaceX, the profit will be very moderate. But space technology is truly multidisciplinary. It is both hardware and software. You can't separate it out. From the advanced materials to electronics to control system to chemicals to computing to communication, I can list it. So next good step, so you don't do satellite and launch vehicle. One of the many value-adding chain, there are so many value-adding chain. It may be a chemical, it may be something else, it may be a nozzle, it may be one precision machining. Be in that chain and be a vendor to big system maker. Risks are lesser and returns are moderate, but are sure. Earlier, you had to be going only to ISRO. Now, many companies have been opened up. They will need it. As you will be a qualified vendor, high reliability assembly. Once you become a high reliability assembly and qualified vendor subsystem, you will get global contracts. Many of our small SMEs are doing it also. Then comes to ground system. These two are up in the space. But there are so much on the ground system to support launches and satellite operations. Many people don't know. Sriharikota, the people think only the launch, but it has got so many tracking facilities. Things like radars, tracking system, fuel filling equipment, automatic testing systems, etc. Many of the automatic testing system is done there by an Indian company, Indian IT company. I don't want to name it because people will think I'm telling about one item or another. It's done by them. There, people come and operate there. Since the advent of small satellites, which are launched in hundreds, is no longer one event, be it OneWeb, Starlink, and many others. Demand for good ground systems are going very, very high. Already a foreign firm, again, I'm not naming it, has tied up with an Indian company about a month ago. They got approvals for under a new policy. Still many opportunities are there. Now, I said space, then being its vendor, then ground systems, they're all very closely linked to space. But now comes to the less glamorous, but which gives very good returns. Ground systems is moderate, it's okay, but not so much risk. And moderate, very good returns are the downstream application business. Direct home TV, communication link, position location system, etc., many of them. In fact, many do not know, 80% of the space businesses in terms of money value are in these. They may not be glamorous, they may not know, but they make money. And they do good job. Without them, it can't go to reach people or businesses. Already, there are many players in India, but they were constrained so far because it was routed through Antarix Corporation. And the entrepreneur could not tie up directly with the foreign companies who will give a better satellite or better terms. And they can't go directly. Now, anybody can do anything and provide there. The COVID has shown up dramatically that broadband access is a major challenge to many Indians. Not because of the costs, but because many of them have a terrain in hilly areas, which is still a problem. Many areas in India cannot be northeast and many other places, marshy areas, etc., and remote areas are there. Space technology, even rural part, space technology, one very good thing is it does not worry about terrains. It doesn't mind the hills, it doesn't mind. It doesn't require a fiber, it doesn't require towers. No need for any of them. So the speedy implementation of a truly digital India, up to now they were not going, they were depending upon their fiber. Digital India can be done in 3 to 5 years. Everywhere, every nook and corner. If entrepreneurs give affordable solution to users, whole of India is there. Now this is not a brand new technology. Already things are there. I will finish it fast.
1 minute, sir.
The whole business could be useful with GIS starts, space-based business projection. Now your imagination in ingenuity can create relatively low risk, high return proposition. Small point. Ahmed Buhari told me to talk about Kulasekarapatnam. I did a lot of these things and found out it is being considered. Yes, it is being considered by Spaceport as it is much closer to equator than Sriharikota. Land acquisition is partly done. But the challenge is a further challenge to do this. I would not like to put a bet on that. Perhaps even the acquired area is a good example, good thought to have a space and high-tech park with enterprises providing various high-value assemblies for space, ground system, etc., what I talked about. That will be a better economic and employment generation perspective, as I see. This is my personal opinion. We'll discuss on that. Now, last but the least, some of you, Kumaraj has told me to tell something about the skills. Now, some of you may be rightly wondering where all this skilled workforce is going to come. First, veteran ISRO engineers, many retired and active, looking for challenge. They could not have many before. There are hundreds of them. Don't look for newspapers. Their names will not occur in newspapers. You'll have to go and find out. See, you shall find it. Second, many young fellows who are already in ISRO and DRDO 3-4 years, and thanks to government not having any pension for the government servant beyond 2005, any of them can leave any time. Give them good packages and get them. Now you need a big force. Look at hundreds of engineering colleges in India. Don't go by IIT, NIT alone. I am deeply involved in AICT, CII surveys on industry, even though I have finished that off. I can assure you that things have improved over the past decade. Many of them have wonderful young
people. I have to interrupt you now.
I'm finishing now. Automobiles, mechanical, electrical, etc. And Tamil and several states of India. Tamil Nadu alone has got 552 engineering colleges, 37 universities, 449 polytechnics, 566 arts and science colleges. don't leave it to your HR people. Sorry to say this, because they are tuned to recruit for IT. Here, see what they have done product. There are a lot of fellows who have taken aeronautics and other things, and also IT there. I stop here. There's much more to say, and I will wait for the Q&A.
So you've got thank you very much. Very incisive comments. Very incisive comments, but we have more time to discuss other things also. So we will cover some of the things that we left out. Chandra, I know you are quite passionate about this area. So I thought I'll start by asking you, you know, one of the compelling imperatives for sustained success in innovation through technology is that giant leap from a startup to a scale up. Since you co-founded such a big company, how do you think entrepreneurs can achieve this? Mute, you're on mute. Velachami, we need one innovation where as soon as the person starts speaking on Zoom, mute goes off.
There should be a warning coming up saying you're muted. Did it show up, Chandra? No?
No, I didn't see it.
It doesn't happen.
No, I think it came. I think it came. Yeah, it came.
Yeah.
So, Keshav, I think it's a very pertinent question, important question. You know, it's just relating to my own experience at Cognizant for 25 years. You know, there are three factors I would consider are very important from startup mode to scale up mode. Right? First and foremost is remain in a startup mode. Don't get your mind to be big organization. Then everything will fall. Everything will falter actually. So first and foremost, always remain in a startup mode in your thinking. So you are agile. You know, you are looking at a big problem, but then you are starting small, and that small company mentality should be there so that you are a lot more entrepreneurial and looking for better and better ways of doing things. So don't give up that startup mindset. The second important thing is, I would say the skills. You know, it's not that, all of us have been in the technology area for the last 33 decades, and we have seen so many changes in technology, right? If I look at the way I began my career, I could sustain my career just sticking to COBOL for probably 15 of those 35 years, right? I didn't have to learn anything else. But things are changing. Now, every 5 months, every 6 months, there's a new technology you need to master. Otherwise, you become sort of irrelevant in the scheme of things. So I think the second most important thing as we look at organization is they need to retain talent, but retention of talent also needs to sort of be dovetailed around upskilling talent, reskilling talent. So talent is important, but constant reskilling and upskilling is going to be very, very important for us to remain on course to leverage technology and deliver superior value to customers. That's, I would say, the most important thing. And then the third one is actually a differentiator. I think you mentioned about innovation. It need not be a brand technology innovation, but even application of technology to solve a particular business problem can be an innovation, right? So we should, I think that's, there's a lot more scope in coming up with very unique solutions, leveraging technology to solve a business problem. So if you are innovative in the way you approach customers' business problem, you will find a niche for yourself, and that will help you sustain the growth momentum that you need. So innovation, skill, and the startup mentality are the three factors, I would say.
Excellent. On that note, I'll move to Velachami. You are so used to working in the Silicon Valley, where you have some unique assets that we have seen, presence of technology giants, world-class universities, abundant venture capital, and hyper-competitive, yet a very collaborative culture that celebrates both risk and failure, I think. Now, frankly, Tamil Nadu has the potential for all of these ingredients. And if you look at all our states, many states are talking about all of this. Nobody has actually executed incisively. What is your recommendation to the state of Tamil Nadu?
I would say that In my previous talk, I was talking about this opportunity. See, the whatever Silicon Valley has, there was a huge barrier. Like even, I would say even Bangalore for that instance, because one is the location, getting the ecosystem, et cetera. I think this is a very good opportunity to build these micro ecosystems like everywhere. Because a lot of that, so the world is moving from physical to virtual, or at least it has a taste of what virtual is. My advice would be, I heard a lot of good things that Government of India is doing and even Government of Tamil Nadu is doing. I would say, how do you provide this ecosystem? How do you make sure that you have 5G available everywhere? I would say, how do you make sure that the educational institutions and part of it, how do you create an ecosystem between all these educational institutions so you can create like a micro Silicon Valley pretty much with like every college, et cetera, by providing the infrastructure from the government side. And then after that, things will automatically come up. There's a lot of questions people ask me like, look, what would attract international? I don't think you need to attract international. I think that as long as you attract local Indian companies to build all of this, all international companies will automatically come. So how do you help build the ecosystems in these micro ecosystems in a lot of these smaller places? I would say that's what my suggestion would be. How do you build it?
Excellent. Chandra and Dr. Rajan, would you like to add to that since it relates to Tamil Nadu?
I can, I've been in many forums. One of the things that we talked about is, if Tamil Nadu has what it takes to be the best in everything, right? Whether it's education, physical infrastructure, technology infrastructure, anything that you ask, industry specialization, whether it's auto, healthcare, everything is there. But one key ingredient that is missing is actually the social infrastructure. And so because of which, we're not, just as people are flocking to Bangalore, you don't see people flocking to Chennai or other parts of Tamil Nadu. So we need to create that type of an environment through social infrastructure that can actually attract global talent into Chennai and or other parts of the Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is the most urbanized probably state in India. So if you look at the social infrastructure, I think the pie is probably pretty full. That's one piece missing.
Professor Rajan, anything you would like to add? Muted, you are muted.
Come. Okay. It came there, you are muted. It comes there, notice comes there.
He was testing it for me.
So Zoom had that facility. So I would say with respect to Tamil Nadu, it has got a number of advantages. I'm talking vis-a-vis the space businesses. Of course, there are other parts of the country, but Tamil Nadu's excellent thing, as Chandrasekhar pointed out, lot of educational infrastructure, roads, etc., etc. And space, as I said, you can't do everything sitting at home. You have to do hardware, you have to do those things. There, that is where I talked about the 552 engineering colleges. Right from the south to, they're all spread out. It is not concentrated in one or two cities. They are spread out all over. So these, and then thanks to new education policy, earlier they will say, if you put a small, allow your industry inside, where did you put it? That'll be a question. Now they will allow this industry interaction so much. They can put something there. Some startup can come around there. We have tried it earlier, but we couldn't do it because of the regulations. Now, 449 polytechnic. So all these things, another good thing about it is Tamil Nadu started many of the colleges as early as 1970. People may say mushrooming and all that, but they are the people who have really supplied to IT sector. So they have all matured at around nearby. Say, for example, you can distribute the thing. Various small towns are there, which are very good. Tier 2, Tier 3 towns are all very good. So these are the advantages. Now I will come to one more thing, which is something special vis-a-vis the space. Many fellows who are, the veterans, who are all settled in Tamil Nadu or Kerala. Because SSTC was there. Not necessarily they have to be Tamilians, but they were all there. They have lived for so long, so they take it there, including some from Andhra Pradesh. So they can attract many of them who will be willing very easily. So these are the very good benefits. And then I told about the colleges. I know personally how good they are. How good they are. Very good. They are all taking aeronautics. Syllabi. And 10 years ago, they couldn't get a job. They will go and get it for IT. They will all apply for IT. Now they are doing products for some of the best companies in the world. Now, lastly, one part is a difference from the IT. He said that local companies are okay. For space, because of so many developments which are taking place and not all captured in India, we will require foreign talent and foreign collaboration. And that will bring in a great thing, and then they can put. That is the reason I said some of those places can be for high tech and others can be given by Tamil Nadu government if it wants in a very, very good pace. And then the social infrastructure, what he said, actually contains within it several euphemisms, which I would not like to expand upon. So it's a very beautiful word he has said. You have to break it out internally and then do it. You tell it openly, people won't like. But they have to face it.
That's why I didn't say it.
No. You're a veteran. Therefore, you know how to say it. That is the great difference between Gurgaon, Bangalore, or Noida.
Excellent.
I know many companies who will come when I want CII. Oh, I will ask a young person. You will ask so many things that I have done due diligence and other thing, R&D center. Then I will catch hold of a young lady who was there. I will tell, where will you go? Yes, sir. First is Bangalore. Then that also got together. That you can't produce. But that part of it, they have to give attention. It requires a little bit of a political will and other parts of will. But if that is done, it will really, because it has got connections. It has got a diaspora connections, which is far superior to many others. And they're all very good. So with that, I will end. Immense possibility.
We'll move to the next question.
If they don't catch it now, some others will take it.
Sorry, let's move to the next question. We have a lot of questions actually. So, I'm going to put you in the spot a little bit, Chandra. We now have an election result in the US. At least one person feels he has won, the other person is not sure he has lost. But generally, we are all comfortable that, President-elect Biden will become the new president. It is an interesting opportunity for India, with the new dispensation to collaborate in many areas. And while quite often we focus only on tariffs, on GSPs, on the, trans-Pacific discussions and stuff like that, I think the biggest opportunity for India and US is around energy, green energy, and, new forms of energy collaboration, which can be bigger than the defense side. How do you think, we should approach this?
I mean, I'm not an energy expert, but definitely...
How does Tamil Nadu benefit? That's the point I'm trying to ask.
Again, another salient feature of Tamil Nadu is actually the clean energy, right? The largest producer of wind energy, wind farms are actually located in southern part of Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is actually a surplus power state. It's mainly because of the natural renewable energy that are being put to use. So I think there is a lot of scope for improvement in the energy area, and definitely the state can be leveraged. And already it's being thought about, and there's a lot of initiatives that are underway.
So what is your advisors? What is your advice to the entrepreneurs in the energy sector here? Because there are a lot of people listening. How should they get advantage?
I know of a project in IIT Madras where they are trying to tap solar energy, for example, and then create a hybrid grid for every home. So every home should be able to function using solar energy. But even the solar energy sort of is low, then automatically the grid energy comes into the place. So actually, IIT Madras seem to have developed a microgrid. If that is put in place in every home, the dependence on the grid power is going to be significantly reduced. They are saying to the extent of even 60% it can reduce. So there are a number of innovations that are happening. We need to put to, it probably is staying at IIT Madras in a research stage or a prototype stage. We need to have an industrial, sort of way of broad-basing it and making it available for every home in the state or in the country or in global stage. I think that there's a lot of room for that type of industrialization that can happen around power, renewable power.
Thanks. Velchami, question to you. You know, Silicon Valley has shown us the advantage of generally moving from proprietary and a siloed concept of innovation to much more open innovation models. Can this actually work in India? And if yes, what are your suggestions to build such collaboration models?
Yeah, I think if you look at Silicon Valley, right? So we talk about the ecosystem. So normally we talk about funding, et cetera. But I think the other part of this ecosystem is all the advisors, the VCs, and people that actually are all connected. So if you look at a lot of this, there are maybe like a few VC firms that have investment in a lot of different companies. So it automatically builds an ecosystem. And there are a lot of areas where there is how do they collaborate between the companies that they have funded, et cetera. So all of this, I think, would become, once you get those ecosystems in place, okay? The other ecosystem is the universities. So a lot of the people that found these, I mean, if you look at Stanford, for example, in the Valley, I mean, a lot of the Silicon Valley startups have come out of Stanford. And then a lot of these people know each other as also. And there's a lot of like entrepreneurs who are continuous entrepreneurs. So there is mostly, if you look at the Valley, most of the founders actually know each other, not necessarily like through a company, but there are a lot of other social connections. Either they came from the same university or the VCs are the same, et cetera. I think that is what actually makes it, instead of being siloed, there is a lot of vetting of the ideas, et cetera. And I think that is part of building the ecosystem, getting the, we talked about virtual ecosystem, but there is a physical ecosystem as well. I think once it gets developed, all of these will automatically come. And also once you have a startup, a successful startup, there are going to be a spin-off from that. People are going to leave that and then they're going to found like another company, et cetera. It's sort of, once it starts, I think it grows fast. Like how do you get it started? How do you provide all the infrastructure? That's what we need to focus on.
Fantastic.
Keshav, you know, if I can interject, just to give you in a lighter vein, you know, I have seen number of occasions, you know, when I go to buy a medicine in the next door pharmacy, if that guy doesn't have, he will ask me to wait. He will send a boy to the opposite store and get the medicine for me, right? They actually collaborate. And the same thing happened vis-a-vis also. I think we shouldn't be really worried about, even if it is a competition, unless we collaborate together, we may not create a good ecosystem for the end consumer. I think that end consumer mindset is important. If that is there, I'm sure, you know, a lot of collaboration will happen, a lot of innovation will result.
Thank you. You know, Dr. Rajan, I have an interesting question which has two questions in it for you, because you have so much of experience. You have to answer this carefully and briefly. One is, you know, with all this excitement about space, entrepreneurs may also feel restricted by the government policies on space. What do you think government should do if they're actually serious about developing the Atmanirbhar philosophy with Indian entrepreneurs in the area of space? That is one. And the second thing is, what do you think India should do in terms of curriculum and course creation in order to create a new kind of talent to, you know, to actually manage businesses of the future?
Thank you. For the first one, I had already given a fairly large preamble. Now, my appeal is, don't worry about the past. What was there about 2-3 months ago? 2-3 months ago, that answer is valid. If now there are no restrictions at all, let them read the press releases and the policy. Anybody can bring from anywhere. He wants to work with ISRO, you can work with ISRO. The technologies will be given. Of course, all due terms. and they have created that in space to do it fast. Already, as I said, I am aware of about more than dozen very good companies. Somebody is already doing, even in the restrictive regime in Ahmedabad, many satellites. Now he is increasing it. So ground systems. So entrepreneurs now cannot use that as alibi. Then he is not an entrepreneur. He has to go and find out what the changes are. And it is very simple. If you are getting a foreign fellow, Shivan himself has given, you go through the FDI route. He doesn't have to come around to go. So that part of it is not there. If they cannot do that, then they are not entrepreneurs. Now they have opened up everything and they are making facilitating mechanism. So second part of it, curriculum. Fortunately, AICTE, that is why I said about past 10 years, AICTE has done one thing. They could not change everything. Affiliated colleges, even Tamil Nadu colleges, many of them will be affiliated. The whole archaic rules are that only the university can do whatever curriculum they have. These fellows won't have, except they get autonomy. It is a very complicated process. But AICTE allowed, you can have co-curricular activity. They take away some of the months and other things during the course themselves, 4 years of engineering college. They have done a tremendously good job. That is where they have done products which are satisfying companies, automotive companies, high precision work for, I don't want to name the companies, high precision, non-corrosion, everything they have done. So now if their autonomy is given, they will become, they can do real curriculum. That is, you are doing your own lessons. This is assured in the NEP. The NEP, now we have to see some equally the orders coming in, but I know AICTE is very committed to do that. So on that count, it will be left to the colleges to work with industry and then make. They are almost, many of them are just industry ready. They have been, because we just interviewed many of them, reviewed there, not for getting a job, but AICTE, this one, interaction, industry interaction, review, very good. They are about, it has become about 90%. And another indices which AICTE is seeing, employability index of them have gone up because of this co-curricular. Now with the NEP, it will open up. Now it is also for industry to, instead of saying, we will come, that is why I said, don't use the earlier HR, this one, how many marks you got, how many, that's not, how many, what skills you have, what you have. Otherwise, they were cutting off. I know the IT, these ones will be, enter the marks, they will cut it off. Here, the fellow may not have necessarily have the mark, but they will have all the skills. So these methods, if they find out who have done what product and then go to it, almost they have to go campus wise. They can do it. Lot of it can be done by these online method, but they have to physically go and see some products. So then they have to also suggest, do the following. I need the following. And the colleges were responding at the time of 6 months, 1 year. And companies actually spoke on that because they were all big companies. Some of them are foreign companies also. In software, in many other items, but we looked at mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, etc., etc. So on that, it is also partly the responsibility of industry to go and tell them, Are Baba, are you ready to do this? We are not guaranteeing jobs. But if you do that, chances of your fellows being picked up is very high. In addition, I would suggest that there is some mechanism, I don't know UEF or anything, some mechanism is required, not only for work, some of the items which Chandrasekhar said about, even for the energy sector, etc. Lot of this knowledge base exists, but how to link them? India, had it been a siloed policy country, many don't know how to intermediate. We did it in Taipei, it is called knowledge intermediation. So for some time, they can pop up as consultancy companies.
But thank you very much, sir.
Not cheaters. You got to have somebody who can do that. This you do. If you do this, you will go into this, link those people. Then IT systems itself will have a lot of opportunity.
Thank you very much. That was quite a detailed answer. I will now move to the audience questions. We have a few minutes and I have three audience questions. So Chandra, you know, taking off from where Professor Rajan spoke, one question coming is, and this is directed to you, considering the increasing adoption of technology in every sphere of life, how can India benefit from this? And therefore, what skills and upskilling should people do in their lives in order to be relevant?
I think just as we have seen in the recent past, you know, leveraging the digital, you know, implementation at scale, with where it has benefited every citizen, right? Continuing on that journey, we will come with, we can potentially come up with phenomenal new solutions applying technology. You know, in fact, had I continued my talk, I would have talked about how we are evolving from a, you know, sort of a tech-based, single stack tech-based solution to a combination of technology stack to develop, you know, a platform-based offering, right? One platform can be a healthcare platform, right? How do we improve the status of a primary health center in a rural area? We can actually apply telemedicine. We can have a kiosk in a primary health center where the patient goes. We can monitor virtually every parameter of that particular patient and offer advice remotely. So you bring expert healthcare to a remote primary health center, which is a great healthcare platform and application of technology that can make it happen, right? Similarly, in the farm sector, you know, how do you further enhance the agricultural productivity? That's another application of technology that's going to significantly enhance our life. Education, you know, it's what we have seen in the last 8 months is phenomenal. You know, in fact, I've been supporting a school in a remote class through, I worked with an NGO called eVidyaloka. They are actually taking a, you know, mobile handset. They have given tab for five students to share in a community center because the schools are closed. So there's a volunteer teacher actually teaching those kids English. So classes are happening virtually. So it throws open enormous possibilities, you know, when you look at, you know, solving these problems, leveraging technology. So I think, you know, it's only going to get better and better, you know, if we think of technology-based solutions. And they've given the country of our size, the only way we can scale is applying technology. And that's going to open up newer possibilities. And regarding the skilling, you know, as I mentioned, you know, it is, I wish I could be starting my career all over again. You know, there's so much to learn. And, you know, you can actually, just as Professor Rajan mentioned, you know, if there are all people who will offer me a job, I'll be very happy to join a company and start all over again, because there's so much potential, you know, so much to learn, and so exciting, actually. And there are a number of ways, you know, you can upskill yourself. You know, I guess, you know, you've been part of NASSCOM. NASSCOM has launched this Future Skills initiative, where already courses are available to do the fundamental courses on AI, data analytics, data sciences. You know, today you can certify yourself. And then by January, we are going to open it up for third-party vendors to offer courses on a paid basis. Again, by March, government is going to come up with incentives. So if I reskill myself and get myself certified, I may get even an incentive from the government to upskill myself. So there are so many things that are being put in place to help people to remain current and remain relevant. And that's going to be good for the industry. That's going to be good for everyone concerned, actually.
Amazing. So in fact, I must say that one of the big announcements India made recently, Prime Minister made recently, was permanent work from home as a policy. And one of the things that we are also working on with the government is to relax all the labor laws centrally and in states, as a result of which we are hoping to encourage part-time employment, the gig economy, bring more women into the workforce who can work part-time, and more importantly, bring back great qualified scientists, doctors, and people like Chandra who can never retire. So Chandra, there is tremendous hope. You know, you will be part of a new ecosystem where after your retirement, everything, all of you will be back working, but for maybe 1 hour or 2 hours a day, and creating new magic for India. So that change, you must all wait. I'm very excited about that. So Velshami, next question goes to you from the audience. It says, with virtual interaction becoming the norm, how do you see opportunities post-COVID, even for, you know, your platform and, you know, virtual platforms and things like that? And what are the new technology areas of research happening in your area? If you could briefly answer that, that'll be good.
Yeah. So one of the thing that's happened is, if you look at Zoom was like an enterprise play before COVID. And now we realize because it is so easy to use. There is a lot of consumers using it. We ourselves have started looking at a few verticals, like education, for example. Now that Zoom has been sponsoring a lot of these K-12 institutions worldwide, et cetera. So a couple of areas that we are focusing directly is education and healthcare, et cetera. But the other thing what Zoom is also doing is making it a platform so anybody, any vertical, there are so many things that can be done with this technology. How do you make other entrepreneurs to start using it? So we announced something called Zoom Apps, where you can go build an app. And you can also, we also provide like a complete SDK for like whatever the platform. You can use the video, audio, every part of it, and you can build your own vertical applications, et cetera. So there is a lot of opportunities in this area. And Zoom, I don't think, can target everything. So the idea is build the ecosystem so there are other entrepreneurs that can come and build on it.
Excellent. You know, actually, there was a question for Dr. Rajan also, but he has already answered it in the last one, which is around private-public partnership and things like that in the space area. So I will not ask him the same question again. And we are also reaching the end. So I must, you know, first of all, try to sum up. I think there have been some really great discussions with all of you. And first thing we must have comfort and confidence around is that India has actually responded very admirably during this current pandemic, leveraging technology and great people. While, you know, the economy actually declined because of the, you know, of the nature of this pandemic, the opportunity now to grow in new areas over the next few years and drive significant surpluses is now staring us in the face, right? And therefore, the new base actually allows us to create great excitement for the future. Every business, the panelists have said, is now a tech-enabled business, and new models will now start driving the future. So I think entrepreneurs, students on this panel listening in should now start looking at, you know, how to re-pivot or pivot their models, because everything has changed. Work from home has become a norm. Working on virtual models have become a norm. Technology is the great enabler. We also spoke about the fact that a new president is taking over in the US. Potentially, there are many areas of collaboration between the two great democracies of the world, and green tech and areas around technology are areas that, you know, we should be focused on as opposed to the traditional areas. In terms of business models itself and business areas, agri-tech, green energy, alternate energy, high-tech manufacturing, new areas in information technology and SaaS. We just saw the Bain SaaS report come out recently. All of it can drive a lot of momentum for India. And when I say India, obviously it's also Tamil Nadu. And therefore, coming to Tamil Nadu, we have always seen that Tamil Nadu has led the way. And with its incisive policies and focused kind of attention on specific industries that they must choose, planned infrastructure creation, encouragement to startup and innovation hubs, along with a very refocused approach to education and skilling, I think will actually deliver the goods. I think the panelists all seem to agree on the fact that this can be a big initiative for Tamil Nadu. Overall, the comments we heard are talking about how India and Tamil Nadu can emerge stronger in the global era. And I am very, very optimistic that in a few years from now, India will now be referred to as a hotbed of innovation with the right policy making, collaboration, and execution across academia, business, and government. I sincerely thank you, Chandra, Velchami, and Dr. Rajan for spending your very valuable time with us today. And thank you to all the members of the audience and the organizers, especially Ahmed Buhari, for putting all of this together and bringing all of us together in this virtual meeting. Thank you very much.
Thanks to the chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Keshav.
You did a fantastic job.
Thank you.